They're starting.
We're entering Frozen City Night.
As am I.
Online. I want to confirm that no one is echoing off my audio setup here.
I don't hear any echo.
You're echoing.
Oh, no, I am echoing off of yours.
Okay. Down just a little bit. Test again.
Test.
All right.
Already doing some plugs.
So quick.
Yep. All right, Ike, go kill yourself. I'm gonna go kill myself. Are you in, Army?
I am in.
I'm interested to see which team is gonna be quicker on the draw this time. Which team is gonna have the faster attack plan?
Well, it seems
that the PGI guy is gonna be aggressive.
Seems that Golden Eagle is already taking Jenner Valley. And the drop deck for Golden Eagle is 2 Timberwolves, a Raven 3L, which I can only assume has ECM, and a Shadowhawk. And PGI's team DevHax has already taken up positions behind the ridge, where most puggers go, with a Nova, a Stormcrow, and a Protector.
Yeah, it looks like they're sitting right here on the ridge. Not one of the move.
And now we have the Golden Eagles moving up towards that ridge. Oh no! Team DevHax has actually sort of abandoned their nice positioning. And the confrontation should start right now.
This is it. And they're all loaded out as brawlers as well. Gordon Gecko takes point. He's already engaging Nico, but he jumps right over him to take shots at the Nova.
It looks like
Novas
my game
are deadly if you ignore them for too long.
More SRMs coming out to play. Looks like all SRM builds here.
Nico already goes down.
He goes down.
And the Nova has overheated. Carl Berg is
High Life is using the speed of his Raven to circle around the enemy mechs, which are all a lot slower. Legan is airborne.
And Golden Eagle is focusing on Bombadil real hard.
My game crashed.
Bombadil is down.
Two on two now. Legan's trying to take out the Nova. His SRMs are just cycling just in time to get off another shot, but nope, he doesn't take it. He waits until he has a good shot, and he opens up the rear armor of that Nova. He's trying to finish him off, but the Nova's protecting the rear now.
Catcher Kill is coming around with his protector to get a better angle on the fight. Legan has lost both of his arms.
Yeah, that's it. Legan's down to ballistic weapons. So he's gonna look for the crit with the machine guns and that LB-10X, but he doesn't get it. He's down.
And so is Carl
Berg. Got his laser batteries and his missiles. But that protector is fresh. Can the protector fight the light with the circle strafing? And it looks like the Protector is going to be able to land solid hits. I don't know if the High Life is going to be able to make it out of this one alive.
Now, High Life is already cored CT, so he's not long for this world, especially against an almost fresh Protector.
Nope, he is down.
That's game.
Oh, is that... Looks like I'm kind of catching up since I disconnected, but it looks like that's one for PGI.
That is one for PGI indeed.
Alright then, that's awesome. That's a great game. That was an interesting game because we were talking about earlier that if you're going to be in clans, try to stay away from bringing a scout, but both teams seem to bring some sort of form of scout, did they not? Or no, we've got...
PGI did not. PGI brought two Stormcrows, a Nova, and a Protector.
Yeah, that's true. All right, I'm going to hop down and tell them what to do, and then we'll get started again.
User left your channel.
Well, let's do a bit of post-game analysis. That was actually somewhat surprising. I'll be completely frank, I didn't think PGI was going to hold up very well in a tournament format. But then again,
I didn't think that they were going to I didn't think it was going to devolve into an all-out close-range brawl immediately in that game. I had no idea that that PGI holding their position there was going to result in our other team here coming in and just charging directly into their position. And I think the eagerness to cross over that ridge is what ultimately defeated them. Like in a lot of pug games, when you come over that ridge too quickly and there's already a firing line established there and they're waiting for you, too much damage is done to you before you can retaliate, if that makes sense.
Yeah, and BMR kind of brought up this point I see. It's like, I thought that the devs were boned when they got caught out of position like that, but, you know, PGI made some really quick adjustments.
User in your channel timed out.
They easily adapted. You know, it was back and forth the whole time. It was good. Looks like we're getting things started. We've given them their 10 minutes to switch up mechs, change up players, change up mech bays. And then once they're ready up, we will get things started. But we were talking earlier that PGI would probably bring brawlers, or anyone. After seeing this, it was pretty common for people to bring brawlers, you know. And they did exactly that. We saw a lot of brawlers this match.
Very true.
Will they change that up or no?
It's kind of hard to imagine a matchup 4v4 on Frozen City that doesn't bring brawlers. I mean, we only saw one real Gauss standoff yesterday, and that was the only long-range engagement, and it wasn't even all that long. That was just sort of in lower in team one main base.
You're very right. Most of these games have revolved around the large laser batteries and the SRM batteries and how much damage you can do at close range as soon as you peek through cover, and that's the idea behind the Frozen City map. Is there's this large confrontation area in the middle with this, you know, geographic barrier of that downed spacecraft, and you start on either side of that. You can tunnel around it or you can go around the valley on the outside, but the main confrontation area is between that spacecraft there, and as soon as you have a firing line established across it, you know, brawling is going to take you up close to it, get you killed. Long range fire, you know, you got
long range
coming over that hill. Long range, when you long range fire and you're over the hill, you gotta get it, you know. But yeah, you gotta shoot. You have to have a target to shoot at, man. And that hill is just the big piece of geographic, you know, division between the two teams in this map. So one team has to cross over it and expose themselves, and that is the killer move. That's the game-changing move here in this map.
Another thing to notice is Gold Eagle brought a Raven, which I can't really say that was effective because it doesn't pack much of a punch unless, you know, again, it really comes down to how great of a light pilot you are. Not saying he's not a great light pilot, but PGI didn't bring any lights at all, and they had a large damage output, while most of the damage output for Gold Eagle was focused on their heavier mechs, while the light was simply running around.
Yeah, I find that Ravens are so much a support mech. They're not there to do damage. They're there to scout. They're there to provide ECM cover so that your T team isn't being rained on by LRMs. Mm-hmm. But when you don't have the LRMs coming from the other side, that's and you already know where the enemy is, that's like three quarters of what the Raven's supposed to do. That can be done by literally any other mech. And so you can put that 35 tons towards a Jenner, you can put that 35 tons towards an Ember. There's more better things, a better role for that light mech to fulfill.
Right. But one thing that you got to consider about the Raven and bringing the Raven to bear is that when you have a team of three people and you're trying to get them to maneuver slowly because they're more slow than you are, despite you being slower than a Jenner or a Spider, you know, you have to get that team maneuvered into the correct position with your intel. You also are the fourth man of a four-man team, and you have to be able to do some damage. The Raven is excellent in that it can move and it can maintain a high damage per second rate versus other light mechs. And it's actually very good at the suppressing fire. It can draw the attention of the other team's, you know, heavy and assault batteries, and while, you know, its teammates are moving into position. So the Raven is actually a very interesting dynamic in a light mech. It's very good to see in a tournament setting.
Yeah, but I think in the context of simply rushing in to immediate conflict, I think a Raven, I'm not sure if it was appropriate for the drop deck for this round.
Well, the one thing that you should consider is that choosing a Raven, which is a light mech that allows a little bit more of a damage spread than other light mechs, also allows freeing up other tonnage to bring heavier mechs with the other players. So there is that option.
That's true.
Of bringing to bear more firepower once you have that Raven rushing in and scrambling up the fight a little bit. And you got to admit, the Raven can be quick. You know, it can.
Yeah.
It can change up the tide of a battle really quickly.
It absolutely can. We've seen that before in previous games before the Beer Warrior Brawl. Right. It also is worth noting that the previous game, Team DevHacks brought a drop deck 5 tons under the max, while Gold Eagle hit the max at 240. It's interesting. I think what they decided to do is exactly that. They put a Raven in so they could ton up other mechs.
Yep.
So. We are almost ready, waiting on one, and then... you've got a couple minutes left.
Gordon Gecko's tail detached, and he's working on, like, collecting it. Putting it back on. Oh, there, he's got it. He's picked it up. Taking company command. One sec, I gotta do some IT. I'll be right back.
Well, I don't think this would be a very good inaugural tournament without some technical difficulties, and I just realized I didn't record that one.
That's okay. So the stream automatically records it.
Stream automatically records it. If it'd be okay with you, Red Sail, would you mind if I highlighted and exported to my YouTube channel so that we sort of have the collection of the recordings all in one spot?
I don't think it'll let you do that. I have to do that. We'll talk about it later.
Yeah. But with that in mind, I'll make sure to hit the start record button before we get into match.
It's okay.
Excellent choice.
They have 2 minutes left.
I think that's about time, right? Oh, 2 minutes? Yeah, this is me, the official. That good time.
Well, as long as the team's ready, I mean, they can drop whenever they want.
We're waiting on one person to ready up.
Tournament needs more Pico.
I don't think anybody know who Pico is besides me.
Well, we need to make that change. We need to change the world.
Lokid is actually already working on a Beer Warrior mascot.
Oh no, Pico's been cast aside. I know that's gonna make him cry when I tell him, right?
That doesn't mean he can't be there.
He can't be there.
So what do you think?
Bad little puppy wingman.
Do you think we're gonna see another 2-0? Or do you think we can see a comeback?
I think we could see a comeback here. The aggressiveness that we saw out of the Eagles was pretty surprising. So if they, you know, reorganize their tactics and choose to maybe play a little bit more defensively while staying on the move, we've seen that be successful. It could change the tide of this match. It'll be interesting to see what happens.
Yeah. I mean, I kind of agree, but I mean, yeah, actually, I really agree. That match went both ways. So, I mean, just
well, the
simply
match
changing
went
spawn
one
points.
Way.
Well, but the spawn, simply changing the spawn points could really change change everything. So.
Yeah, let's see if they change the game.
All right, all players are ready and their time is up. Yeah, fix something real quick.
Okay, just let me know when you drop and I will...
We are about to drop.
Okay.
Raise tonnage.
And the options. They have the tonnage set, the tonnage rule set to zero.
No game for you.
It says 0 to 1200.
Oh, for me? Does it say that? Oh. For me? Oh, there it goes. Now he's turning it up.
Why is it doing?
He's got to turn it all the way up from 0 to, what is it, 270, since we're here. Oh, there he goes. easy way. All right. Refs. Are you good on tonnage over there, Ike? Looks like you are. I see. Yeah, it looks like they're matching it.
It looks good. Guys, 5 tons under.
I might suggest that they're just bringing the same drop deck. Which, it worked well for them the first time.
Alright, we're dropping. Let me know when you get connected, Army.
I'm connected. I'm loading up the game right now. And I'm recording this time! So for those just tuning in, or those on the archives, this is the second game of the 6th match of the first round of the Beer Warrior Brawl. This is PGI versus the Gold Eagle Merc Corps, and PGI took the first game.
That was a mouthful.
Yeah, it was. I just kept talking. Yes, thank you, Jay-Z. Team Dev Hacks is the PGI team.
Yeah, because it's technically all PGI. There's some Bombadil and Catrakel on there, so. I'm gonna go kill myself. I'll be right back.
Excellent.
And it looks like Gold Eagle is heading straight for that tunnel entrance on their side. But so is Team Dev Hacks. This might get interesting real quickly.
It takes so long for me to kill myself. I want to see.
Yeah, they are both entering the cave. Gordon Gekko taking point for Golden Eagles. And they should run into each other right now. Wow, that was quick.
You may want to hop into pilot view for that, since it's such a small area.
Oh, don't worry, I can actually see from above.
Like, the confrontation is happening in the tunnel, both teams have already confronted each other. Elric's taking point for the Eagles.
Bombadil's getting focused real hard.
Yeah, Bombadil's getting a lot of damage.
Stormcrow's
He's pulling back.
Gordon's staying up in front. All these short-range missile batteries, can they make connections with them?
You know, they pushed in so deep, it really comes down to who has more firepower in this instance. Because they're so well bunched together.
Yeah, well, at this point, what I'm seeing is it's coming down to who can put firepower on target more precisely. And
That's true.
The Eagles are not putting the firepower on target. Okay, Gordon Gekko's starting to lay down good shots, but he's overextended past his team.
He's way overextended.
I think this is going to get him killed.
Oh, Bombadil goes down.
Bombadil's down. Looks like his team is pushing in from the rear with their attention divided. Will the PGI team
be taken by the aggressiveness of the eagles again?
Gordon Gekko goes down.
Gordon goes down.
Carl Berg has been legged in Nova.
The
those
combination
legs
of ballistics
so
and missiles.
Carl is
Carl
down.
Berg goes down.
Nico has
Nico
lost
goes
a leg.
Down.
And all that damage is transferring to the center torso. He's destroyed.
Oh,
that's
wow.
A 3-on-1 here. Can Katra even survive? That's a pretty fresh protector.
Pretty
and we know
fresh.
That they can deal damage. But Legan is pretty fresh himself, and that Shadowhawk has an excellent damage output, even with just an LD10X and 2 machine.
Patrick Hell is so close to overheating on this map. Oh, he takes down Elric.
He's taking out
Katra
one.
Is certainly doing work in his
don't
protector.
Fight. That leg comes off, his mobility drops, and all the damage is going to start to soak up there. Alright, are they going to go for that other leg, or are they just going to keep doing target practice here with him? Critical damage. They're
well, the
Raven
is certainly focusing that
leg. What are
they
shooting? The side torso. Let's get some focus, guys. Slow down. If he's not shooting you, you need to focus your fire on what your target is. Okay,
oh,
that's
out that
leg. He's down.
Man, my heart is beating. We're already going to have a one-on-one battle. This is crazy. Going on our third round. That's one for Gold Eagle and one for Team Deathaxe.
That means that excellent. There was only one match this entire round that went 2-0.
Yeah.
That's correct.
And actually, whoever wins
this
next
game
will be fighting them.
Yep, that's correct.
Well, that's interesting. I gotta congratulate everyone on setting up a really awesome, pretty fairly balanced tournament. This is turning out to be an excellent game.
I mean, the fact
matchups
we really
are
had...
great.
Yeah. Alright, then I will head down to them and let them know what to do.
I will head out to the bathroom and let myself know what to do.
User left your channel.
Yeah, so just so that we can keep the commentation going, the chat is talking about how the Gordon Gekko push that everyone just sort of went, what the hell is he doing? He's jump jetting into the middle of Team DevHax. That was actually the turning point in what pushed it over for the Golden Eagles.
I can't disagree with that, actually. That's actually a really good point because, you know, he was a pretty... The Timberwolf can take a lot of damage, and putting him in through there, everyone focused on him while the enemy team could put fire on Team DevHax. I actually agree with that. That was a big turning point in the battle. It's like one of the big moments where maybe overextending yourself and forcing yourself to be bait is okay. You know, if it's planned, then that's great.
Well, and the Timberwolf is quite beefy. I mean, it's much... Mm-hmm. Much harder than one might imagine for just a 75 tonner.
Sorry, I'm gonna butcher your name. Munitrino.
Munitrino.
Yeah, he's saying that it pulled pulled PGI into different directions by all that movement, and that's true. It did pull PGI in a lot of different directions, and it forced them to their fire to become all over the place. So, although Katrakel was still fresh at the end of that game, and he already took out one mech, and he was about to win it for them. He could have. So we're gonna wait a little bit longer.
Back, gentlemen.
Did you tell yourself what to do?
Yep, and I did it afterwards.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that was quite an interesting fight right from the get-go because both teams just went straight for the tunnel. I mean, if we didn't have that spectator mode, no one would have actually been able to be spectate the beginning of that fight. So, shout out to PGI. Thank you for allowing this tournament to use the spectator mode. Really, really good stuff.
And you know, I think it also should be noted that, once again that PGI bought another drop deck that was 5 tons under. And we were talking about earlier that if you come to brawl on the tunnel, it will come down to how much firepower you're bringing. And once again, Gold Eagle brought that Raven and focused all their firepower on heavier mechs. I can't say whether or not that was the cause of their victory, but that's definitely something to consider.
You know, one thing that's really interesting to consider is the way that PGI all focused their firepower on that overextended unit. And the fact of the matter is, in that tunnel, that overextension by 20 to 30 meters, it looks bad, but he's drawing all the fire, he's still dealing damage, and his teammates are no more than 30, 40 meters behind, still all within range of their short-range weapons.
That's true.
All able to immediately deal damage. So there's three people there able to focus fire on targets that aren't even shooting at them. By the end of that confrontation, those three mechs were still fresh.
Yeah,
and,
but you can't...
they were able to deal a lot of damage.
Mm-hmm. And as I think Harak Day says, you can't ignore that Timberwolf behind you at the same time. You can't just let him get behind you and ignore him. Because he's going to put down a lot of damage. So if anything, you know, you've either got to focus on him and push him out, or you've got to send two to focus on him and two to watch your back. I mean, what do you do in that situation? Because that is
that's
a very...
Exactly right.
Well, I think that, at least from my perspective... A fatal flaw from the team dev hacks, they didn't put their Orion front and center. So their tankiest mech was sitting in the back, allowing the Stormcrows to get hit on, the Novas to get hit on. It's kind of hard to say, yeah, those mechs can take hits. Because they can't. We saw Carl Berg, he got legged. Nova's legs are... I've been piloting Novas quite extensively for the past couple weeks, and Nova's legs are very, very squishy, very reminiscent of the Centurion legs. And they just fall out from underneath you if you're not careful.
Do you know what time I walked... Do you know what time I went down into the meeting room? Forgot to turn on my timer. I think it was at 33, I believe. Yeah. Okay. Sorry, continue.
But yeah, so even though the clan mediums can field an absurd amount of firepower, especially for their tonnage, they just cannot take hits, and they will melt underneath a focused firing line.
Very true.
And, you know, this actually, I think this is the second tunnel brawl we've seen. Second or third?
At least third, because we had the dual stalker Canadian Expeditionary Force tunnel brawl.
That's true. That's the one
and
I'm thinking of.
And we
what
had Red Sail. You were actually in a tunnel brawl, if I remember correctly, as well.
No, we almost got into a tunnel brawl, but
like,
we walked
you
out
were right at the mouth of the tunnel.
Katib says it's the third one. Which one am I not thinking of? I know there had to be another one. I'm just not thinking of it.
I don't remember any other tunnel brawls.
J-Man, they have played two games so far this match.
This is the tiebreaker. This is the final match.
Right now it is 1-1.
Who do you think right now will pull out of this after what we've seen? I've seen a lot of skill out of Team DevHax. I've been a little bit surprised by how well they can focus fire, call a target, stick together. You know? Even at a last-minute drop deck, last-minute formation of groups with filling in alternates, they've done very well.
Yep. Without a doubt.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to call, actually, just from the showing of the two matches that we just saw. It's kind of two different setups for the same match, so...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm excited in anticipation.
It looks like, just looking in the lobby, it looks like Team DevHax is switching up their mechs. So.
This will be interesting. There's been a major switch up on this side as well.
Oh, then we should see something interesting.
No spoilers for the for
my
the stream,
team under.
I'm sorry.
I think my team might be overtoned by 10 tons, isn't it?
They are overtoned by 10 tons.
But
go ahead and let him know. Run out of the 3 minute limit here. I think allowing teams to switch up their mechs between matches really makes it interesting. Because otherwise, the entire tournament would have been completely one-sided. You know, if one team just happens to bring a drop deck that's just not working, and it just happens to be weak against the opponent's drop deck, it doesn't really define pilot skill at all, or team skill. It simply defines, oops, we brought the wrong drop deck. That's so I think it's great that we can switch up drop decks mid-tournament.
Plus, as we've seen with teams that get defeated and then come back and win the last two rounds, it seems to give your pilots a chance to refresh, you know, regrouping, you know, pulling back from the battle, assessing your tactics, you know, not even necessarily getting tactical, but just getting, getting a warm-up game in and then pulling out a different drop deck can completely change what the result is going to be. It's like shooting a shot cold bore, you know, the rifle does what its natural tendency is, and your team's trying to do what its natural tendency is once you're in the cockpit and you're in your mech, and the game
I'm sorry to interrupt you. Khatib says that the other tunnel brawl was between Commando and Comstar regulars, and that's true. It was right at the entrance. I totally forgot about that. Yep.
Very true.
That's true. All right, looks like we're all green here. Oh wow, PGI. Okay. Green over here. All the tons are correct.
I'm good to go when you guys are.
Oh, they need to set full teams to know. I will not say anything until the game starts, but drop decks have changed.
Alright, good to hear. Interesting stuff going on over here. Let's see if that drop deck change proves superior.
Well, PGI has done something. I'm curious why they've done it. What's going on here? Whoa! Unready. What are they doing? Nope.
They're hacking.
Breaking the SRMs as we speak.
Well, it sounds
like... There's technical difficulties with the lobby at the moment.
Oh, there it is.
There it goes. Okay. So, everything's good. I panic avoided. that's another thing we stated. We haven't stated it. It kind of occurred at the last minute. Teams are only allowed to spawn an Alpha Lance simply because no other team has been allowed to do it, and we can't allow one team to do it and not everybody else. So
very true.
Let's see here. Yep, we're all green. We will drop soon.
Okay.
Gordon's asking Gorshin for some premium time.
We'll throw this match for some premium time codes.
All right, we've dropped.
Excellent.
And I'm loading in. So this is the third and, ties notwithstanding, final game of the final match of the first round between Team DevHax and the Gold Eagle Merc Corps.
And Team DevHax has dropped 10 tons under with a TBT 7K, Timberwolf Prime, Shadowhawk, and a Nova Prime. TBT is Trebuchet, right?
Yeah. Yes.
So.
Interesting. We have the same drop deck from the last round over here at the Gold Eagle, and I'm in a spider. I fucking was like sitting back in my seat, like chilling, ready to watch the game, and I gotta have to pilot something to destruction.
So Gold Eagle has already taken Jenner Valley again, just the same as they did the first match, and they're actually dropping in the same drop deck. Two Timberwolves, a Shadowhawk, and a Raven 3L.
So it looks like Team DevHax is headed for the ridge.
Yeah, this is sort of very, very, very reminiscent of the first match.
It worked for them the first round. Why not again? Bombadil is peeking over the ship.
They're not going to see him. They're all the way down in Jenner Valley, almost to Theta in Congress.
Yep. Oh, Team DevHax is pushing into the city.
Yeah, it looks like the Gold Eagles are flanking around the left side of their map, B5 to C5 area.
And I know we had discussed this tactic in our game, flanking around. What happens if the team has already pushed across the ridge whenever we flank? But it doesn't look like PGI is checking their rear. A lot of them are focused forward.
Well,
so
the two teams have just completely missed each other, actually.
Yeah,
PGI is heading towards spawn, and Gold Eagle is already behind him.
See, that's the thing. Gold Eagle has that advantage already. They understand that PGI has pushed through the ridge, and right now, Team DevHax is kind of searching around for them. They can't find them. They're splitting up. They're looking for them.
That's right. And guess who's taking point with the Gold Eagle Merc Corps? It's Gordon Gecko with that Timberwolf loaded out with the SRMs, Streak SRMs, lots of them. So he's looking to do some close range light hunting, medium hunting, and he's also got medium pulse laser machine guns to back that up. So what is going to happen here? They've parked themselves in C4 D3 corner.
We're getting some commentary inside the game with a lot of game chat. Let's see. Looks like Nico is still checking Bravo 2. All of them are still focused on the enemy spawn. They're only just now turning around to face the ridge. But they're still scattered. They don't know which direction to look. They haven't set up a defensive position. They're just simply looking for them.
The geological cover is absolutely shrouding the Gold Eagles here. They're off the side of the map, and if the PGI team doesn't come and look over here, they will be hidden for as long as they want to be, and they can peek at any time, but they don't have the recon out establishing where their enemy's position is. You know, they're going to be surprised whenever this the attack happens.
Well,
so they don't take the initiative.
They're, yeah, like what I was saying earlier, that Raven 3L really shines in scouting roles, especially with that
ECM
cover.
Yeah, but are they using it? Are they using it to scout, or are they
sticking
with the
group?
No,
he's just sitting there on the other side of this ridge.
I almost feel like he was kind of a throwaway. Maybe I'm wrong. I feel like he was a throwaway to get the other mechs to turn up.
Yeah. Team DevHax is now moving south towards the position of the Gold Eagles, but they don't know where they are right now. It's kind of interesting. Gold Eagles are now starting to move north. And they might actually see each other shortly, but they've stopped again.
Yeah, the Gold Eagles are trying to hold this ridge line. They really, the problem with this is if they hold this position, they do not have the height advantage on a team that comes up on them and discovers them in this position. They're not very defensible here, honestly, even though they're in a hidden position. They're not in a very defendable position, so they need to move
They need to get recon. Go ahead and find out where the enemy is.
Well, Team Death
Raven's
Hackers...
trying to peek out, and the Raven cannot seem to lock any targets, so...
Team Death Hacks has pulled back to the ridge of the ship. They're back to the original part where they're just going to sit there and wait for the enemy, I believe. I think it's a wise decision. Just searching around, spreading out, looking for the enemy is just going to get you killed.
All right, so we've got both teams waiting for the enemy. That means whichever team gets anxious and wants to do the damage is going to move out, and we have a target. The High Life has spotted the Stormcrow off in the distance. I think I identify that properly.
Team DevHacks is pulling back.
It must have been a Shadowhawk. Team DevHacks has a Shadowhawk, a Nova, a Timberwolf, and a Trebuchet, but no Stormcrow this round.
Might have been the Nova.
So at least we have someone identify where they're at. Just a quick go over the rules. If this game does go to a tie, it will simply switch sides. Nothing will change. If it goes to a fifth round, we will go to conquest.
Copy that.
Well, it seems that Gold Eagle is actually moving out now. They are moving towards the west, and trying to maybe get a flank around Team DevHacks, but Team DevHacks is now set up in the pocket. They are trying to scout the tunnel, probably using seismic sensors, because they still have no clue where the Golden Eagles are.
Mm-hmm.
That's right, with the Timberwolves forming a wall, pushing their large direct firepower up in the front. They're expecting to establish contact. With the way they're moving, they're patiently stalking around these hills, looking between the buildings. They're expecting to establish contact over by this this spawn point. But the fact of the matter is, they're not going to contact the enemy unless they go deeper into that city. They're not even exposed themselves here to damage, so we're not going to see a confrontation for a couple of minutes at least.
I mean, unless Gold Eagle decides they want to push up, I think Gold Eagle's pretty committed to their position.
Yeah, the High Life is trying to peek again with his Raven. He peeks, no visuals.
It may come down to Gold Eagle is deciding to wait till the last minute and then finally pushing in to get one kill. So we could see something like that happen.
The Gold Eagles are actually positioned where... here because Beer and Trashy's Canaries had their game 2 confrontation.
Just to go over a quick time check, it is currently at 7 minutes and 38 seconds remaining.
That's perfect because spectator mode doesn't have a timer, so that's good.
Copy that. The High Life has fallen back and the Timberwolves are taking point again. This group is moving.
Oh, Team DevHacks is pushing. Team
DevHacks, where are they pushing towards?
They're pushing towards Epsilon-ish.
They see something. They must have seen something, otherwise there's no reason for them to be pushing like this.
Alright, well this is the furthest out we've seen any teams on this map. We've officially reached F3 with this group, and they're still in one contiguous lance, which is great to see. That Raven has not split off to do recon. Actually, the Raven has limited his throttle to match the speed of the Timberwolves at about two-thirds of his throttle, so you can tell he's patiently sticking with his group, being careful not to overextend.
Well, in contrast, Team DevHacks, they're sticking together, but they're a little bit more spread out than I would say Gold Eagle is. They're still searching for the enemy. They're pushing in the correct direction, but they're too spread out, I think.
Team DevHacks is actually now following pretty much the exact same line that the Gold Eagles were just sort of sneaking around. They are now...
Gold Eagle's Raven, the High Life, opening up his throttle, reaches 150
they must have seen each other
per hour
by now,
to peek over the hill.
But I don't know.
You're
so
to
close!
I want to zoom in a little bit, Army. You're pretty... Oh, they see each other? There is contact.
And it seems that Gold Eagles were caught a bit off guard, even though they've been so careful to keep together. It seems Team DevHacks rolled initiative on this one.
Yeah, but they're still unsure. They can't find a position they want to hold. They're focusing on that Timberwolf.
Alright, Gold Eagle has committed towards this approach. They're coming in through this building, moving towards the west, and they're all attacking that Timberwolf, Bombadil.
Bombadil, yeah, Bombadil is their prime.
He's absorbing all that damage, and unfortunately he's got behind the building to where now they're having to come under fire from the rest of the PGI team to strike at him. There's no cover for them now. It's all going to be kind of a free-for-all in this building.
Bombadil's lost a leg, and he's down.
Bombadil's down, and the rest of the team is not putting down any fire on these guys.
It's
the
so
PGI
close,
team is taking a lot of damage here. The High Life is going to come around this building and try to use that Raven to strike at the Trebuchet, which is just
down.
Taken out Gordon Gekko. That's one Timberwolf completely destroyed. The Shadowhawk and
about
another Timberwolf are still alive.
Catrakel's
they're trying to
down
focus
his
the fire
lasers
on Catrakel. He has no
and Carl Berg is falling
and now
Nova.
Nothing. He's gone.
Nico is still completely clean.
Nico's
they're focusing
up
on him now.
He's got his full firepower, and let's see what Legan is doing. He's got all of
Nico
his weapons still online.
Nico is sprint CT.
He's still got all of his close range weapons though ready to fire, but he doesn't take any opportunities.
Oh,
his leg
Nico
is destroyed and
down.
He's down. He's down. Wow, the Golden Eagles are playing very aggressively. Elric's lost half of his weapons, but he's still engaged in the fight, shooting at the back of that Nova there. Oh, that's the front. Oh, is he going to get destroyed
Carl
here?
Berg is
there's
the last one
there's
alive.
An opportunity to take out Elric. He's lost
Nova's
his
Nova's doing a lot of damage, but they
only
cannot stand
here
up under fire.
Can he take him out with only one weapon? No, he's lost it. And now what's going to happen?
Carl's leg is down, and that goes to Nova.
The leg goes down, and PGI is destroyed. That's it.
Game goes to Gold Eagle Mercor.
Wow, what a turn of events. Like we were saying earlier, I mean, that, you know, we originally thought Team Death Hex had that one, but, I mean, Gold Eagle changed up their strategy. That's
what
really
an
what
excellent
it was.
Surprise. I loved watching that match. Very
I'm sure they are
well
very
done.
Excited.
One thing I really enjoyed was watching the High Life and that Raven peek over that hill like with his full speed and just you know, take a peek, look both ways, and then drop down, motion to his team with the actual mech physically to go up the hill.
I'm gonna go grab them and pull them in here.
Excellent.
User left your channel.
Actually, it seems like I'm stuck in spectator mode. I've been
joined your channel.
All right, let's pull these guys in here.
User was moved to your channel. User was moved to your channel. User was moved to your channel. User was moved to your channel.
All right, so I have Bombadil, Catrakel, K-Berg, and the leader of Gold Eagle Mort Corp in here with us. How are you guys feeling?
Man, the adrenaline is going after that. It was so frustrating trying to figure out where they were.
Yeah.
I felt like any moment we were going to turn a corner and all of them were going to be there, so we kept trying to keep everybody together. And then I saw him, and you should have heard me on comms. I was freaking out.
I don't believe you.
Oh, I found him! I actually found him! They're still on the map!
Gordon Gekko, I don't know if you know this, but you are muted. I'm not sure if you are aware. But yeah, we watched you guys circle around each other, and we were talking earlier that, you know, it seemed like Team DeathX kind of had the round. They had a really great strategy. They adapted well. You guys did great at that, but then Gold Eagle switched up their strategy completely. They moved in behind you guys and just sat there for a long time until finally they decided to move and you circled around each other and it got down to the wire.
Yeah, I tell you what.
Go ahead.
No, you
first.
It's all you.
I already talked to you first.
I just thought the way that Gold Eagle came through that building with their whole lance all at once while you guys were distributed through those buildings was the deciding factor
User
at the end of that game. Just
channel.
The brawl
User
with
was
the
moved
geological
to your
cover
User
protecting
was
all
your
mechs
channel.
Ended up being the turning point that allowed them to focus fire and take you down one by one.
And we have Gold Eagle with us now, too. Great games.
Congratulations, guys.
Excellent game.
Yeah,
congratulations,
guys. Great games.
Great games, guys.
So, How about that adrenaline? I mean, my heart's pumping. Curly.
Well,
crazy.
I'll tell you what. I think the calling factor on that was the psychological warfare that you guys did as far as avoiding us for so long, because I was losing it. I mean, I was literally losing it. And I realized that I'm like, I got to take some deep breaths and find my inner peace again, because I was going crazy. I'm like, how can we not find him?
our best help was High Life. He kept going up and checking for us and looking to see if there was anything there. And when, you know, it was just great. It really was. Our biggest worry was Catrickel.
Oh yeah,
he was killing us.
Don't blame
him. Yeah, Catrickel was definitely putting the hurt on everybody. We were going to ask you guys, Golden. We noticed you guys brought a raven to ton up your other mechs. Was there a reason behind that, or did he decide he wanted to be a raven, or were you just trying to ton up your heavier mechs?
ECM. We wanted to ECM, and we wanted to run two Timberwolves. So yeah, the extra tonnage went to the Timberwolves. Yep.
So I got to ask, what the hell made you guys do a tunnel rush? Because we thought, oh, they won't do a tunnel rush. Nobody does a tunnel rush.
That was probably the best moment in this first round, was two teams just making a beeline for the tunnel. And I was watching from spectator cam above you guys. I went, these two guys have no clue. They're just going to run headlong into each other into the tunnel.
Legan, I'm going to let you explain that one.
It's an old fart problem.
Well, I can relate.
Gordon said, "What do you want to do?" And I said, "Let's get stupid and run the tunnel." And then I told him, "I said if they do the same thing, engage them first."
That's exactly what we did.
Yeah,
that's
crazy. Yeah. We were talking about that too, because we at first we thought, you know, I'm not sure who was. I think it was Gordon with the Timberwolf just jump jetting into enemy territory, overextending himself. We thought, what an idiot! But then we realized, no, he's a genius. He charged in. PGI was completely turned around, and the rest of you guys could easily just wail on their back armor.
They totally disrupted our ranks. I mean, we were called target primary and alpha, which was one of the Timberwolves, and then whoever that was that we targeted first, you got into cover, which totally fucked us all up. And then we were just scrambling to find primaries again, and yeah, you did a great job of making us turn around in circles.
Yeah, I took that one time.
Oh, go ahead, Mark.
Yeah, when we were in the tunnel and I jumped over and I saw three guys face me and I was like, perfect.
Job well done. Exactly.
That was one time that Catrickel was around the corner and couldn't get back into the fight. That really helped.
That's true. As we were talking earlier in the meeting room, Bombadil, it seemed like your team had kind of formed your drop deck kind of last minute. Was there any, you know, what was the thought behind that forming that last minute? Do you wish you had started that earlier? Or?
The thought process was that we were literally forming our team up to the last minute. So we just did the best that we could. I mean, we were trying to use mechs that we were familiar with and had some practice in. We did get to play a little bit beforehand and kind of warm up. But yeah, it was just, it's holidays up in Canada. And so thankfully, Brandon was available to sit in with us.
Well, we were super excited to have all of you guys here. That had to be probably one of the most exciting matches to watch, back and forth. And it was, I've had a lot of fun watching you guys, and we were super excited that we got to have you.
Yeah, thanks for giving it your all.
Thank you, Beer Warriors, and thank you guys. You totally deserve that win. Hope you go on to win the tournament, because then that would make us feel even better.
Yep. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Well, thanks, they do guys. Have their work cut out for them. Next round, they're going up against the Commander Orgy House, which is made up of ex-members of 007 from Headhunters of Davian. They're the first team to sign up for the Elite Bracket.
They're from GK.
Oh, GK?
They are from GK. They are made up of the old 007. Gordon and I both were in HHOD.
So we got some past relationships between these two teams coming up. This will be
definitely
interesting.
Yeah. By the way, we know they're good, and we respect them. We don't fear them.
Good. We're glad to hear that. Just to add on, I hope you don't mind me plugging this, Bombadil. No Guts No Galaxy had decided to help us out and has given a reward at the end of this tournament. So we wanted to give you guys a quick thank you, because you guys are so awesome for helping out the community. This is just a tournament we decided to put on ourselves, and the fact that you guys wanted to come over and help us out and give us a little bit of a initiative for the teams was really sweet of you guys. So we wanted to thank you for that publicly.
Hey, we're more than happy to do it. And it is co-sponsored by NGNG as well as PGI. They're helping us out with the prizes. But like I mentioned to you before, we wish we could do more. We, you know, soon the mechanisms will be in place to where we can do some bigger and better prizes as well. But yeah, we're super happy to help you guys out.
Excuse me.
Exactly. Believe me, man. You think I love giving shit away. Believe me.
Yeah.
Well, you know, too, something that most people don't know, Bombadil is one of the people over on No Guts, No Galaxy that helps you set up a channel, and he did an awful lot for us, and I really appreciate what you did for us over there, getting our channel set up, Bombadil.
My pleasure. I mean, it's all, everything we're about is the community, and so this has just been an awesome event to watch and take part of. I've been totally impressed with the numbers, people coming out and watching it. You guys put on a good show. And hey, Wobbly Wednesdays, those are still happening, right? Are those...
Oh, they happen
every
Wednesday. I have not missed a Wednesday since the first one.
Yeah,
I've been drunk every Wednesday. I'm a Wednesday alcoholic now. It's just my deal.
I have a feeling now that after this tournament, Wobbly Wednesdays
I have to plug one thing, a new beer that I think is just fantastic, and that's Miller's Fortune. Please try it.
Oh,
it's 6.9.
It's actually good.
And now this has become really a Beer Warriors brawl.
Yeah, we've got a whole list of beers we've enjoyed, craft beers, non-craft. We stopped doing it, but we used to have a vote on beers. But anyway, we wanted to thank you guys. We've had a lot of fun. Just to go over the next round, it will occur next weekend. As we said earlier, you guys will end up facing Commando Orgy House. You will be playing on Caustic Valley, and your tonnage has jumped up dramatically to 270. So your strategies are going to be all over the place for this, and we're super excited.
Well, we can't wait to watch it. We will promote the shit out of it and be there to watch it as well. So, yeah, thank you for allowing us to take part. It was an honor.
Absolutely.
It was thanks an honor for to being here.
Yeah. So
thanks for playing.
We wanted to thank all this, the audience too, for coming in to come watch. We have probably
hell
the biggest showing we've ever had.
Yeah, we reached 66 viewers during that
stream.
Wow, pretty awesome.
Right on, guys.
68. Dustin says 68. So
I sure am glad Gordon kept pushing his macro that advertises Gold Eagle Merc Corporation. Oh no, that's wrong.
Yes,
I guess you should have done that, should he?
We did catch that in the spectator mode because I can see the team chat.
Well, congratulations again, Gold Eagles. You guys were awesome.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you. We're out of here.
Take care, guys.
See you guys later.
See you later.
Disconnected from your channel. User disconnected from your channel.
So,
user disconnected from your channel.
What do you guys think? What do you think we're going to see next round?
User disconnected from your channel.
I think the ability to ton up is going to allow a lot of these four-man groups. Okay, pay attention to one thing especially, is that we all established some of our favorite loadouts during this tournament. I think the four-mans are going to have some similar loadouts with an assault mech included, or with another heavy mech rather than a light mech. That extra tonnage is going to allow them to bring you know, more of their favorite chassis into the field of battle. So
yeah.
I think we're going to see probably a couple less mediums would be my guess. There's going to be less medium mechs.
I think we're going to see that, but it's also a lot hotter, but I think people are pointing out constantly, we're going to see LRMs. Just that's if it wasn't an expectation the next last round, it's going to be an expectation this round.
There will be some LRMs.
And I don't see why there wouldn't be, to be honest.
And
so I'm
because
I do expect to see a Direwolf. I expect to see a Direwolf. Is this the heaviest tonnage limit in the tournament?
That
bracket,
is correct. 270 is the heaviest.
Okay,
tonnage.
So that is the heaviest tournament bracket. Bringing a Direwolf leaves your other three teammates 170 tons to play with. So
yes.
that could bring actually two Direwolves and then two 35-ton mechs.
Yeah.
Adders, two Adders, two Direwolves. That's a viable build for
and
this
then,
next tournament bracket.
No, or two Direwolves, two Kit Foxes with the ECM triple AMS C right arm. That will be the ultimate anti-LRM lights right there.
That's right, but guys, everybody that's... watching who doesn't know, the Direwolf is a huge... huge risk running in a four-man tournament, because if your enemy gets behind you or to your flank, adjusting your firing angle is very, very difficult. Whoa. And slow. It's a very ponderous mech that it doesn't acquire targets quickly.
And Khatib pointed out that only if they allow clan mechs. And guys, you can unmute yourselves if you like. But I wanted to point out that the semifinals is at Crimson Strait Conquest, and it is the lowest tonnage.
Yeah, 220 tons, I believe you set that limit, right?
And not only that, you can only have two of a specific weight limit, a specific weight class. And then the finals will occur on HPG Manifold. Game mode will be Assault. The tonnage will be 250. And the it will still also have the max of two per weight class. So.
All right, excellent. And tell us what the maps are for the last two battles as well.
It was Crimson Strait and HPG Manifold.
Respectively, excellent.
I must say, excellent map choices,
stuff.
By the way. I love that Terra Therma is not one
user
of them.
Was moved to your user was yeah. moved to your channel.
I'm just moving everybody in here, just why not?
Now it's a party.
But, so yeah, I mean, Wobbly Wednesdays, I have a feeling, are going to get super huge. So I might have to take up Bombadil and get a new TeamSpeak server for sure.
Oh wow, we're in here now. What the hell?
Yeah.
Good.
I was still listening to the stream. I was like, what the hell's going on?
Now you're hearing something. Wait, is there an echo in here?
My own voice.
Since I'm in here now, Icarus, some people brought up an interesting point that next week is a holiday weekend.
Yes.
So how is that going to mesh with the
Yeah, we've games? I've already had a couple teams say they are not available Saturday. If that does happen and a lot of teams are not available, I'm going to have to improvise and come up with something else to do. It may come down to doing something like during the week. I'm not sure. It'll come down to people telling me that they're not available. We'll figure that out.
I can tell you that the Drunken Samurai Canadian Expeditionary Force match will be happening on Saturday, probably around 8 p.m. CST, because Madcat and I were talking about it last night after our matchups was determined.
Right.
And another thing, the videos of the highlights will probably be up later tonight. We'll probably post them on YouTube as well.
I will certainly be posting my recordings on YouTube.
Yeah. Yeah. So, we're happy we had everybody.
Your channel was edited.
We'll probably just kind of keep talking, maybe play a couple rounds of something. I'm kind of tired. I may go grab a drink or something, then head back, and I'll stream it if we need to. But we were glad to have such a large audience. I've never had such an audience like this. So much to the fact that we had to switch streamers mid-game. Because, dang, that was great just to have such a great audience.
Yep, I can concur. And great contenders. Dude, can you tell us the story of what happened to your the Beer Warrior Brawl banner here? It looked good, and now there's, some MS Paint, just text up in there, and, somebody took a caption machine and just, shit.
I just used the OBS text display to change the time on that. So
I had a new one.
That's some quality shit right there.
I had
there
a new one, and I was streaming. I was streaming earlier, and then for some reason audio wasn't working, and so we just went ahead and switched over to Army of One, and I didn't have time to send him a new banner. So he had to compensate. So
gotcha.
That's what ended up happening.
I see.
So of these teams, Drunken Samurai, we don't know. Canadian Expeditionary Force, our Cinderella story, as Khatib has said. We've got Gold Eagle, Merc Corp versus Commando Orgy House, which I cannot wait to see. Team Jackie Chan versus Here Because Beer, Homewreckers versus First Grunwald Regiment. Those are going to be some awesome games.
And I just went ahead and put the bracket up on the stream for everyone to see.
Oh, good, cool.
What's interesting is
the
level
of... So I was just going to give a little background on us. I mean, we are a joint Arcab Legions Ninth Sword of the Dragon Team.
Oh, that's right. You're a Drunken Samurai, aren't you?
Yeah.
Oh, I totally forgot. Yeah. So, yeah, we don't know anything about you guys.
We're the mandatory Kurita house in the match. So yeah,
so I expect to see a lot of dragons. Would that be a fair statement?
I will say the only thing I will give away about our builds is currently for round two we're planning on using zero dragons.
Oh man, but that's such a terrible
only
I mean,
round
amazing
two,
mech.
For the other rounds, there's a good possibility there will be some dragons involved.
Well, I don't want them to give away too much about their drop decks or anything, but we're super excited. I mean, I'm pumped. And that last match was so much fun to watch. Oh, my heart, like...
Dude, yeah, it's going to be awesome seeing the round two matchups. Just the level of violence is going to be exponentially greater now that no. Both teams are going to have to commit a lot more to actually achieve victory over these, these winners. I think the... Homewreckers versus the Grunwald is going to be an awesome... These are all going to be awesome games. You know what? They're all going to be insanely great games.
I think the ones... they're all going to be good. Like, I love Here Because Beer because they're fancy men and Cry some more with them. And then Homewreckers versus First Grunwald is going to be really interesting regarding their tactics. And then you've got Gold Eagle Murkrow versus Commander Orgy, and they know each other. And that's the elite bracket. And then, right. Of course, you know, Canadian Expeditionary Force and Drunken Samurai. I mean, that's our Cinderella story with the community group together. So, I mean, if anyone wants to pick favorites and have some banners going on, I wouldn't blame them. There's some great teams here.
I was telling Court that we don't have a chance to see Team Jackie Chan, how they play. So we're going to be going in this blind.
Yep.
That'll certainly be interesting again.
That is true. Team Jackie Chan is another group we have not seen yet. They had a bye into the second round because they were not available on this weekend, I believe. Or was it? Oh, wait, was that Drunken Samurai? Yeah, it was Team Jackie Chan. They were not available during the first round, so we went ahead and moved into the second round. Which I know is sketchy and bad to say, but that's kind of... I had to make some sacrifices.
We'll have to beat them all the same.
See, here because beer has already been... steel and fire proven in this tournament. Team Jackie Chan has not been a show of force yet. We'll see what they bring to the table in the second round.
But that only means that Here Because Beer has actually publicly shown what they're capable of, and we have no clue what Team Jackie Chan will be fielding. So
right, have they watched the tournament ahead of time to see Here Because Beer's tactics and loadouts? We'll see if they adapt to that.
Maybe I should accidentally delete those off of YouTube.
Game footage is definitely online at the moment.
It will come down to how well you guys adapt. Because you'll be seeing tactics you haven't seen yet, and adapting to them quickly is really what it's going to come down to your victory, I think. So... I mean, that's still my only two cents on that. That'd be an interesting game to watch, for sure. I mean, I'm excited.
It's okay. Timberwolf OP anyway. I'll be in it.
You know what? I don't blame you.
Right, Clamex OP, so...
Well, that's no problem. Thing. Do you think you guys will be allowing Clamex for your round? Well, I shouldn't ask, actually, because that kind of affects whether or not they'll allow it, so I shouldn't say that, so... But I have a feeling a lot of teams probably will allow clan mix.
I have a question. If you agreed to clan mix, is that every game from now on
has
that option?
It's each one.
Each one is
it's
different.
It's a match-by-match basis.
Yeah. I mean, not like, it's a round-by-round basis, not like per fight basis.
How do
but...
we get that information from Jackie Chan so we can start planning?
You simply need to contact their team captain or on their go onto their thread onto the Beer Warrior Brawl forums and contact them, ask them what's a good time for them and whether or not they want to allow the one to allow clan mix, and that's it. And then just simply relay that to me. Make sense?
Yeah. Yep. I guess Court, you want to do that, or since you're team
leader? Yeah, I'll get that done.
All right.
Cool. Whew, I'm tired. That was fun.
Yeah, that was exciting.
I'm all worked up, but
I am
beer.
Excited.
I think I'm going to head off for now. I'll probably be back on maybe in 2 hours or so. Grab a beer and play some games. So,
awesome.
I'll certainly be around and streaming on my Twitch channel. So there's going to be that.
Yeah, go ahead and you bring him over to your stream. Your stream, if you want to, and then I'll probably stream later tonight.
Plug.
I've had a lot of fun with you guys. This has been I've had so much fun. I can't say that enough. I've had a lot of fun. I will see you all later. Cheers.
See you all later, guys.
Cheers, guys.
User disconnected from your channel. User disconnected from your channel.
And as we speak, the two games that I got recorded are going up onto YouTube right now.
Cool.
User disconnected from your channel.
Rosie working for the banks of the band and the star of the county town. From Bantry Bay to Derry Kay, from Galway to Dublin town. No, made her seem like the fair kind that I met in the county down. She'd a soft brown eye and a look so sly and a smile like a rose in June. And you held each knot in her auburn throat as she lilted laments and tunes. At the padded and danced me in a trance as she skipped through a cheek or a wheel. And her eyes she'd roll as she lift your soul and your heart she would lightly steal. From Bantry Bay down to Derry Kay, from Galway to Dublin town. No maid I've seen like a fair colleen that I met in the county town. The harvest fair should be surely there, and I'll dress in me Sunday clothes. Wet me hat got right and me shoes shone bright for a smile from the nut brown rose. No horse I'll yoke, no pipe I'll smoke, go to the rest of me plow turn brown. And the smile bright by my own fair side is the star of the county town. From Bantry Bay down to Derry Kay, from Galway to Dublin town. No maid I've seen like the fair Colleen that I met in the county town. She'd a soft brown eye and a look so sly and a smile like a rose in June. And you held it not in her auburn throat as she lilted her mints and tunes. At the Patterton dance she'd be in a trance as she skipped through a jig or a rail.